and let's run this. Notice how it says, what is your name? And it has these funny characters back here. This is a string. And in that string, we have what's called an escape sequence, /r/n. Depending on your operating system, when you press enter on the keyboard, one or two characters is printed out, but you don't see them because they're beyond the printable range. In this case, hard return, new line feed. If you omit those, strange things will happen. Let's duplicate this line and see what it looks like. See how it says, what is your name? And then just instantly, what is your name again? Because we don't have that hard return in there. Add that in, and you'll see it breaks it into multiple lines. So standard out is similar to print, but there's some caveats you gotta be aware of. Next, we're going to say string. String name equals, and we're going to use the standard input, and we're going to use read line sync. What read line sync does is it will read a line of input from the user synchronously, meaning it will block your program from executing until that function has completed. It can tell that's completed because the user will hit enter, and it will print those characters into the screen, and it'll exit and shove that value into this variable. Seems a little complex, but it's actually pretty easy. We're going to say print name. So let's run this. Notice how it says, what is your name? I'm going to type it down here. It just simply prints out your name. Let's polish this up a little bit here. When we run it again, type your name, and it says hello and whatever your name is. Now, what if the user simply doesn't enter anything? What if they just go enter? It just says hello. Let's fix that a little bit. We're going to say name is empty. And then we want to do a standard error. Followed by colon. Otherwise, let's move this up here. And let's run this again. What is your name? We'll say Brian. Notice how it says hello, Brian. If we run this again and we just hit enter, notice it's in red because it's an error. Name is empty. So that is how to use input output and standard input output along with standard error. Why would you use these? Honestly, the only time you'd really use these in Dart is to get the standard input if you're using a console application. Standard error, maybe if you want to do some logging, but Dart has better tools built in the advanced tutorials. We'll cover those. have a basic understanding of variables and constants, we're going to talk about collections. Other languages have a construct called an array, which is basically a variable that contains other variables. They're very clunky and hard to work with. Dart does away with that, and it does with just basic collections. I shouldn't say basic because they're actually very powerful. The simplest is enum. Notice how I've declared the enum outside of the main function. We do this because enum has to be that way. You cannot put it in main function. If we try to, watch, there will be an error. So enums have to be declared outside of that scope. We'll discuss scope in a future topic. But just be aware that that is a thing and it exists. Now, let's try printing this out. You see how colors is just printing? Well, the word colors, that means it's a variable. There's no runtime type, but notice how it has values and then it's got red, green, and blue. Let's print out the values. And see how it has a list here. You can tell it's a list by these brackets of colors.red, colors green, colors blue. Let's print out an individual color.
Hello. Hey, what's going on? You saying that like I know you or something? I don't know. I don't know this name. So. But, hi.
Now we have colors.red. That is an enumerator, and it's the simplest of the collections. Enumerators allow you to do switches, which is part of flow control, which we're going to discuss in a future topic. It does not have the concept of an array. What it does have are collections, and the king of those collections is the list, and that's what we're going to discuss. We have a basic understanding of variables and constants. So enums have to be declared these brackets of colors.red, colors green, colors blue. Let's print out an individual color. Now we have colors.red. That is an enumerator, and it's the simplest of the collections. Enumerators allow you to do switches, which is part of flow control, which we're going to discuss in a future topic. This may look a little different. We're declaring a variable type of a list, the name is test, and the assignment we're giving it is in brackets 1, 2, 3, 4. What we're actually doing under the hood here is creating a list in memory and saying assign this list to this variable. So what are lists really good for? Well, you can add variables to them. For example, say print test.length. We want to know how many variables are in here. You can see there's 4 items in that list. Let's grab the first item. You can see the first item is the number 1. Let's actually make this a little more easy to understand. So you can see the length is 4, the first item is 1. It's a zero-based index, which means the first item will always be 0. 1 is 0, 2 is 1, etc., etc. We can also do element at a specific index. Let's say we want to know what's at the third index. Well, it would be the number 4, because it's in the third position. If we try to go beyond that to a number we know is not in there, you'll get an error, an out of range error to be specific. Lists go beyond that. They can actually be very functional. For example, let's create a new list. And we're just gonna simply say, this list is called things. And it's just a dynamic list of a generic type. We're gonna say things dot add. So here we have three different data types. We have an integer, we have a string, and we have a boolean, but we can add them all to our list. Let's run this. Oops, we forgot to comment that out. And you can see our list that's printing out is one, cats, and true. So it doesn't really matter what type we put in here. We can put anything we want in this list. Now, let's say we want a list that only has numbers. That's where generics come in. This may look scary, but it's actually very simple. Let's explain it. You're creating a variable type with a generic of int. What does that mean, a generic of int? When you type list, you see how it says list, and then in these brackets it has the letter E. That's a generic type. Generics are actually a very advanced topic, but we're going to cover it a little bit just to satiate your appetite. What we're saying is we want a list that only has integers, and we're going to call that numbers. We're going to create a new list with the integer type. We haven't discussed the new keyword yet. What does this really do? It takes the list class, or the list blueprint, and creates a new object in memory, and then assigns it to this variable. Pretty easy in concept, but it's kind of hard to wrap your head around if you're new to this. So we're going to go over it again. We have a variable type. We have a variable name. We're going to create a new variable. This is done for us automatically. We didn't even realize it. For example, right here, we're actually creating a new list and shoving that into memory. Numbers, and then we're just going to add some numbers. We'll say 1. Now, let's try to add something different here. Let's try to add some cats. Notice how the IDE is smart enough to know that we can't do this, because a string is not an integer. We said we wanted a list that only allows integers. And if we try to run this, we're going to get the dreaded string is not a subtype of int. A set is very similar to a list, but also different. Sets are unordered and do not contain duplicates. So let's create a set now. Notice how it also has the brackets with an E, so we can specify specific types. Notice how we're adding this twice. Let's go ahead and print that out and see what it actually contains. Notice how it only has 1, 2, and 3. Because it already had 1, it simply doesn't add it. A set is very similar to a list, but also different. Sets are unordered and do not contain duplicates. So let's create a set now. Notice how it also has the brackets with an E, so we can specify specific types. Notice how we're adding this twice. Let's go ahead and print that out and see what it actually contains. Notice how it only has 1, 2, and 3. Because it already had 1, it simply doesn't add it. Queues are a little bit different. Think of a queue as a line. Unfortunately, it's not part of the standard, so we have to actually import it. So say import dart collection. Now, what do I mean by they're ordered, no index, and add move from the start? It means they're ordered, they're very quick in memory. there's no indexing to these, and you have to add and remove from the end. You can't just add into the middle of the line. So let's just say, notice how there's a lot less in here. Go first. Remove last. Let's print this out and see what it does. Notice how the only number we have left is 3 because we removed the first and we removed the last. So always think of queues as like a line at the bank. Now we're going to discuss maps. I don't mean the map that's in your car. It's a key value pair. Now what does that mean exactly? Let's define a map so you can see what it looks like. Notice how when you type map, you get the generic brackets with a K and a B. That's the key and value. We're going to do things a little simply and ease you into this because this is a bit of a complex topic here. We're going to say map. People.
And I need to stay off these fucking social medias and shit. They take up so much of your time.
Equal. And then we're going to add some brackets here. Now, we need our key value pair. So we'll say... This is essentially what a map looks like. I'm going to print this out. As you can see, we have a key, a value, a key, a value. You can tell the fields because they're between the commas. Now, how do we play around with this? We need to know the keys and the values. So let's say print people.keys. See, the keys are dad, son, daughter. Now let's get the values. You can see the values are Brian, Chris, Heather. So how do the keys and values really relate to each other? You would use the brackets, similar to using a list. But this case, you would use the key. Dad is Brian. The son is Chris. So what maps allow you to do is add things into the collection and no need to know their index. You can just simply call them by name through their key. Another way of creating this, and let's just comment this out, would be to specify things. And let's say map, we want a string and a string. Now we can programmatically add things in here. Notice how this is a different syntax. It's put if absent. What we need is the key. In this case, we're going to say dad. Now we need the if absent, and it is actually a function. Function is going to be covered in the next topic. Let's go here, and let's say. So what we're doing is creating an anonymous function right here and adding the value. Save and run this, and notice we get the same. comment some of this out and see what happens. Notice how sun is null, because sun actually doesn't exist. We've commented this out. So that's the power of a map. It really contains two lists, a list of keys, a list of values. But what the map does is bridges those two together and links them so that you can call a value based on its key. Now that we understand.
Yeah.
Now that we understand variables, we need to do. Do something with them. That's where flow control comes in. The easiest method of flow control is called a SERP. Let's demonstrate. What assert does is it actually determines if something is true. Let's run this and see what happens. Starting and finished. Let's actually change that to finished so it makes more sense. Now, what if age is not 43? What if age is, say, 15? Save this and run. You can see how we have an unhandled exemption. Failed assertion. This is similar to throwing an error. Throwing errors and dealing with assertions is a lot like hitting brakes. The if statement is a lot like steering the car. When we look at the statement, it's very simple. If this evaluates to true, then do this. The age is 43, so this will evaluate to true. Let's run this. You are 43 years old. Let's make another one. Still says you're 43 years old. Let's change this to, let's say, 67. You are not 43 years old. So what's going on here is it's looking at both of these statements and evaluating. This is no longer true because we're 67. This is true because the age is not 43. And it's running this expression here. Let's try something a little more complex. Got a little ahead of myself there. All right, so let's look at these expressions here. If the age is less than 18, you're a minor. If it's less than 13, you're not even a teenager. What we have here is called a nested if. This bracket right here denotes scope. We actually have hidden brackets right here and right here. What scope is it says everything inside of this block of code will run. If age is less than 18, then run this block of code or the scope. Same thing here. If age is greater than 65, run everything in this scope. What is scope? Scope is a pretty complex topic. We're going to cover that in a future tutorial. Just know for now that you have this block of code that will be run if this is true. Let's change this a little bit. Let's say 103. You are not 43 years old. You are a senior, and you're lucky to be alive. So what's going on here is we've set the age to 103. It's evaluated these, and it said you are not 43, so it ignores this one. You are not 43, so it runs this one. Age is less than 18. Well, it's not, so it just completely ignores this. Age is greater than 65, definitely runs that. And it's greater than 102, so it runs this. Let's change this to, say, 56, see what happens. You are not 43 years old, meaning this is the only one that actually evaluated to true. Let's change this to 10. You are not 43 years old, you're a minor, you're not even a teenager. This is what's called polymorphic code. It means code can change based on the input that it's given. You'll probably hear that term thrown around quite a bit. Let's demonstrate the else statement. Here in the United States, when you turn 21, you are legally an adult. So let's switch to age 21. You are not 43 years old. This is your special year. Let's switch this back to 43. You're 43 years old. This is just a normal year. Notice how the else statement determines which one of these is going to run. You have if age equals 21, run this scope. Else, meaning if it's not, run this scope. And you can nestle other if statements in here if needed. For example, we'll say, run this again. You're 43 years old. This is just a normal year, and you are an adult. So what's going on here is it hits this, evaluates this, and says, is this true? No, it is not. So it jumps down to else. else is going to run regardless because this evaluated defaults. In here, we're saying this is just a normal year, as you can see here. Then we have another if statement. If age is less than 21, this evaluates defaults in this case because we're 43. So it jumps down here and says you're an adult. Let's put this to 17. You can see how it changes. You're a minor, normal year, you are also a minor. Before we get any further, let's talk about scope. Let's use our tried and true example here. Very simple example. We kind of beat this to death in our if tutorial. Let's run this. You are 43. Scope is where a variable lives. You understand now that there are things called variables which will change. You can hit the brakes through assertions and throwing errors, and you can now steer the car using the if statement, but variables have a short life cycle. See the age here? We can use this here, and we can even print this here. Let's change this just so it runs correctly. You are 56. So that variable exists here, it exists here, it exists in this scope, and exists in this scope. So what you're really saying is that variable exists in this entire scope. Every time you see these brackets, think, this is scope. So what exactly is scope? It's just simply a bubble that a variable can live in. For example, let's say this. We've made another variable, and it's in this specific scope. Boleyn has bills equals true. Let's run this. You're 56 and has bills is true. Let's change this. Notice how already the IDE knows undefined name has bills. Let's run this. See how it still runs. Let's change this back to 43. Now suddenly the program crashes. Unhandled exemption. No top level getter has bill declared. What does that mean? Super short version before we get into getters and setters, which is really what's going on here, is that this variable does not exist in the scope. It exists here. The variable has to be used in the scope in which it's declared. In this case, has bills is declared in the subscope. If we were to move this up here, hasBills now lives in this scope here. And therefore, the program should run just fine. If that's not abundantly clear what's going on, we'll break it down to even simpler. The variable exists at the highest level bracket. In this case, it's here. If we were to move it back where it originally was, the highest level bracket, one above, is right here. That's scope. When you're declaring variables and you're working with flow control, pay special attention to scope. If you start getting errors, especially things of undefined nature, look at your scope. We've talked about scope, we've talked about the if and the else statement. Now we're going to talk about switches. For the switch statement, you need a variable. Doesn't matter what kind, just a variable. Inside of the switch statement, we have various cases. Think of this like a giant switchboard. This may look a little confusing. We're going to take that variable age. In this case, it's 18. For you cannot say case less than 18. Notice how suddenly there's an error. We're going to be talking about loops. Let's make some variables. Time use do came down here, evaluated, and said nope. This is a common coding mistake. In this case, you can see value 1, 2, value is 3. This executed. Continue. It's like reading a book. You decide you want to continue reading the book, so it comes down here, evaluates this expression, says it's true, runs this block of code, and in here it says continue, meaning it just continues right along right here. Break, on the other hand, like I said, is that breaking out of jail. Let's jump, rerun this. Value is greater than 5, and finished. So it comes down here, says the value is greater than 5, and jumps right out because of that break statement. We're going to talk about the for loop. It's similar to a loop, but it has a range built in, so you don't have to worry about the infinite loop problem. We can see we just have a list here. Let's print it out. Brian, Heather, and Chris are the items in the list. We want to do something for each one of those items. What we can do is we can say for int I equals 0. Person at 0 is Brian, person at 1 is Heather, person at 2 is Chris. So how does this really work? Notice how there's 3 semicolons, 1, 2, and there's a hidden one back here called 3. So these 3 sections, first you're declaring your starting value, and also access the list, Brian, Heather, Chris, using an anonymous function. People, not for each, and then inside is our anonymous function. The problem with this is that we are not getting that index. So if we needed to know the index of that person, we have no way of getting it. When in doubt, use the right algorithm for you. Just know there's different ways of doing this. Next, we're going to be talking a little bit about functions.
What up, Panther? What up, Mellow? They put John Cena on the cover of WWE 2K again. Like, shouldn't this man be retired already? God damn. So you die and then nothing happens. Okay, sure.
What is a function? Well, we've been working with them all along.
That's all the downloads I need.
Oh, this is a function right here. We're gonna make our own functions. Let's run this and see what happens. See how it simply says testing. So what's going on is the program execution jumps into our main function here, sees our expression of test with these brackets, and jumps down here to our function, void test brackets with a scope. So what's going on is a function has a return type. In this case, we're saying void. Void means nothing. Then it has a name. The name of this function is test, and then some parameters. We have no parameters, so we simply have these brackets, and then whatever code we're going to execute. Let's make something a little more challenging. You can see now it says, hello, Brian. We have void, meaning it's not going to return anything. The name is say hello, and our parameters are string name. We're going to use that string here. The same rules of scope apply to what we talked about earlier. For example, we cannot take this variable and plug it up in here. Notice how the IDE already says undefined name. And we get a no top level getter name declared. What that really means is the scope is within this function. We don't have it declared here. Now, let's actually back up a minute, and let's make it here. Let's see what this does. You can see there's still no top-level getter. And that is because the scope of this variable is within this scope block, not within this scope block. Let's run this again. And you can see that the name is Brian, because that's what we passed. So even though we have two variables with the same name, they have a different scope. In this case, Heather is within this scope. And whatever we passed here, in this case Brian, is within this scope. Now, let's actually do something. Say int dog years int age. In this case, our function is going to actually return a value. We're going to say it is the age times 7. Your age in dog years is, and then we're going to simply call that function, dog years, with a number, in this case 43. Your age in dog years would be 301 if you were 43 years old. Now we're going to make this return square footage. In this case, it has an int as return type, the name is square feet, with two parameters, width and length. All right, let's do this. So what we're doing here is we're creating a bunch of variables, and we're calling our square foot function, just to get the square footage of each one. Then, we're going to make another function. We want to paint a house. And let's say, for example, it takes 10 feet per gallon. We're going to return how many gallons we need per the footage. need about 80 gallons of paint. Something tells me our math is a bit rough. I think it's really about 4 gallons. We've now broken this into functions. Next, we're going to look at optional arguments here. So let's make a function. And let's call it. Let's run this. And sure enough, it works as expected. But what if we want this to be able to say just hello without a name? Notice how the ID already says required one argument, expected, but zero found. Run this and you see we have an error. How do we fix this? Very simple. I'm going to add some brackets and add the default value. The brackets denote that this is optional. Let's run this again. See how it says hello. But there's a problem. After hello is a space. So let's fix that. Let's run both cases of this and make sure it works as expected. Hello, space, and the name. Now, let's get rid of the name here. You see there's no longer a space, it's just that hard return. So what we're doing here is we're saying, say hello, and then we have an optional of name. The name is always there, but the user doesn't actually have to use it. If they don't use it, it's automatically filled in with nothing. If the name is not empty, meaning if there's actually a name there, then the name is now equal to the name pad left, name length plus 1. What does this really do? It just takes the name and adds a space in front of it. That's where the length plus 1 is. And then print out whatever we have. Now, let's show a better example of this. Within the brackets, optional parameters have to come at the end of all the other parameters. And we're also going to open my file too. Notice the optional is within the brackets. Optional parameters have to come at the end of all the other parameters. We've been talking about positional arguments. And what that means is the arguments are in a specific position. The first argument, the second argument, the third argument, etc. Now we're going to talk about named arguments. Let's make an example of a named argument. Here's our positionals. We're going to convert these into named. So what does this really do for us? Well, it allows us to do some things like this. Notice how we're calling those out of order. The signature of the function is with length. If we didn't have these little brackets, this would raise an error right here. Now we're calling these by their name. Footage is 50 based on 10 and 5. So it doesn't matter which order we put these in. We can just simply call them. Now, let's try calling it without that. You can see how it no longer accepts unpositional. Too many positional arguments, 0 expected but 2 found, meaning we now have to call them by their name. Let's make another example. Seems pretty simple, but it's deceptively complex. Let's take a closer look at this. Let's run this. And you can see how it says download my file on port 80. But we never actually put the port in here. That is called an optional named. You can denote this by the semicolon here. We're actually assigning a value to this. Now, we can also grab this and call it out by name. Download my file too on port 90. So that's the difference between a positional and a named. And both of them can have optionals. Let's discuss functions as objects. When we started this whole series, we talked about objects and how everything in Dart is an object. That includes functions, and this can get very crazy very fast. So fasten your seatbelts. This is a function. We're going to change this around just a little bit here. If you look at this code, it may make absolutely zero sense to you. We're taking a variable, dog ears, and equaling it to calc ears, which is actually a function. So I'd finish this up. Run this. Your agent dog ears is 301. Your agent cat ears would be 516. Notice how both of these variables point to the function calc ears. That is how you would use a function as an object. It's not really recommended, just know that you can do it, and it is useful in certain circumstances. Let's talk about anonymous functions. What is an anonymous function? Let's give you a demonstration. Let's run this. You see how absolutely nothing happens. It's a valid function. Dart doesn't throw an error, neither does the IDE, but nothing happens. An anonymous function is sometimes called an internal function, and here's why. Let's make a list of people. We've done this before. And we just simply want to print that out. We see we have Brian, Heather, Chris. That's pretty simple to understand. Here, we're using the print function as an object and using it as a parameter in the for each statement. Let's kind of expand that out a bit, and let's really talk about anonymous functions. So we're going to say people.forEach, and in here, we're going to actually build our anonymous. That's what's going on under the hood. That's what that really looks like. Let's run that, and you can see how it has the same results. So internally, what this really looks like is something like this. You'd have a function return type with a name, but it's called anonymous because it doesn't have those. It's all internal. Let's have a bit more complex example here. Let's run this and see what happens. You see this last one only has Heather and Chris, not Brian. So what's going on? We're saying, in our people list, call the where function. In the where, we're making an anonymous function. In this anonymous function, we have a parameter string name. We're going to switch, and for each one of these, we're going to say true or false whether or not we want it in the where. What where does is really creates another list. Let's look at the signature. See, it creates an iterable dynamic, meaning it's creating another list in the background. Each one of these, we're going to return true or false whether or not we want to include that in the list. In this case, we said Chris and Heather. So we have that list, and on that list, we're going to say for each print. Seems like it's pretty complex, but if you think about doing this in terms of functions, you're actually saving a lot of time. You would have to write about 3 to 4 functions to really return that information correctly. We're going to start down the path of error handling. What happens when you have problems? You've seen me make mistakes, you've seen programs crash, and you've probably made mistakes as you've been following along. How do you handle those? Dart has two concepts, an error and exemption. An error is a program failure, where an exemption is something that can be handled. Let's look at this. If we run this, we know we're going to have a problem, because, well, age has not been assigned, it's null. Let's run this. Sure enough, no such method error. The method star was called on null. What does this really mean? This is called a trace stack. And what you can see is we have an unhandled exemption, meaning this is something that can be handled programmatically. The no such method error is something handled under the hood, and it's being raised. The method star, this right here, because we're multiplying, was called on null. Null is actually our age. Try calling star 7, object, etc., etc., and you can see how it says the line numbers. Now that we know what errors and exemptions are, how do we deal with them? We've still got our code that's not working, and we need to fix this. We're going to use what's called a try-catch-finally block. This is the syntax for the try-catch-finally. What happens here is you try to do whatever in this scope. If there's a problem of any kind, you catch it right here in this catch-all. This is called a catch-all because all exemptions will be caught by this. And finally, no matter what happens above, run this finally block. Let's see an example here. Let's take this, put that in there. We know that will break. That is how you would catch a specific error. Now that we understand error handling, let's look at how we can advance this a little bit and actually throw our own errors and why we'd want to do that. So we can simply do this again, and you can see we now see the bad throw your own custom exemptions. For example, change dog ears to 8 and try to run this. You can see now the exception is dog ears must be 7.
Well, that's it for the course. I'm gonna take a break, make a few phone calls, and come back for the either the floater or the intermediate one. And I can probably knock out all four of these in one day. And I'm wondering now, like, why couldn't I do this while I was at work, right? Crazy.